And with me is Dr. Greg. He's new on the team, really excited to have him.
This is something you can work into your daily routine. Who doesn't have 4 minutes after work?
So we're gonna go into something very unique, and I was really excited that Dr. Greg was gonna do this.
When I first heard this is actually, I was listening to one of Dr. denBoer's seminars.
Exercise is such a central tenet to good health. It has a positive impact on virtually everything that comes to this office.
Body weight exercises are functional. If I had to sum up all of my rehab classes into three basic concepts, it was core stability, proper diaphragmatic breathing, and glute activation. Three things we're terrible at. Before I got into academia in this field, I was in the Marine Corps, and we didn't use weights. We're tapping into an ancient metabolic setting when we do this, and we go into fat burning mode.
This is how I biohack my patients to get a lot better, a lot faster results. I love the US, but I do not love how we administer healthcare, and I'm on a mission to change that. So hi, welcome. I'm Dr. denBoer, and for those of you that do not know me, I'm a board certified licensed chiropractic physician as well as naturopathic doctor, and I got into this profession partially for sports medicine reasons. That's always interested me a lot, how to optimize the athlete while keeping them healthy instead of doing things that are not healthy. And it's really been a rewarding journey, and that of course then morphed into many other things. And with me is Dr. Greg. He's new on the team, really excited to have him. He's a very bright doctor who also is very passionate about exercise. I've seen him exercise, and I don't exercise with him. Have you ever noticed that? There's a reason for that. So he'll be able to give you a tremendous amount of pointers also that I'm excited about. But first, before we get into that, I always like covering some late-breaking research because we are a research-driven practice. And an interesting one that just came out was an project using probiotics. Currently, there's over 300 studies going on in hospitals in the United States alone on probiotics. It's become the new thing, and I'm so happy about that because back when we started, probiotics was not really known at all. I think, probably the only practitioner in the Grand Rapids area using probiotics at that time. And it was like, why? But even 30 years ago, 50 years ago, we knew that the microbiome is very central to health and it affects almost anything. So this study was studying bone density on women that are postmenopausal, giving them a probiotic twice a day, followed them for a year. And when they studied them a year later, their bone loss was less than half compared to the ones that got the fake pill. I'm not even sure how good the probiotic was. Apparently it was doing something, right? But the probiotics, the quality control out there is absolutely horrible. And in spite of that, they still had half the bone loss. That tells you that a lot of the signaling, even for bone density, comes from the gut. In fact, one of the nutraceuticals that we use here to reverse osteoporosis is really a hops-based anti-inflammatory nutraceutical that hits the gut wall, which then gives you good signals to your bone, and you will actually rebuild. On average, we see a rebuilding of bone by 6 to 7% a year. So osteoporosis and osteopenia is reversible, and this one study here proved it. I love relating that one. But let's jump into our topic. Better basics, fitness, form, and function. I want to visit the essentials first. Those of you that know me know that every July or August we do this topic, and I do that because exercise is such a central tenet to good health. It's just a critical component. I feel it has a positive impact on virtually everything that comes to this office, so therefore we've made it quite central to us. Blake, who's standing in the corner back there, is heads up DBC Fit, and that is an office that we have downstairs for rehabilitating and getting patients motivated to move, right? And it has a profound impact on wellness. So then there's the people that want to take it up to the next level, and we do that as well, and that's what we're going to be talking about today. But I want to revisit the essentials that we every July and August cover, and that is number one, stress. If a patient is under a state of stress, it can be emotional, spiritual, or physical, your adrenals are going to be stressed, which then stresses other things. This is why a patient who's had a lot of stress in life develops wrinkles. Wow, where is he going with that one? Okay, listen to me on this one. Stress decreases elasticity of ligaments and tendons, among many other things that it does. So therefore, if you study professional soccer players, this is a European study, you'll note that coaches are less fond of their married players in Europe because they tend to injure themselves so much more. And you're thinking, okay. But this is, just imagine, you're a soccer star. You're gone away from home a fair bit. There's all kinds of gals fawning over you. There's going to be some marital discord in general. Okay? So there's stress. So that underlying stress, they theorized, upregulates the adrenals, which then hardens the ligaments and tendons, and you're much more prone to ankle sprains, knee, hip injuries, and so forth. Isn't that interesting? So stress is a big component. Now remember, exercise is a stress. We're stressing a muscle so it can rebuild itself, right? But there's a sweet spot. So if we overtrain, it's amazing how then overall conditioning goes down. One of the best things that we do with a lot of our professional athletes is tell them to slow down and their performance goes up. And believe me, that's a hard thing to convince them. Okay? So if a patient is under a lot of stress, we advise exercise as a stress relief, making sure that we hit the sweet spot, that it is still constructive and not destructive. And how do you know that? Well, you'll notice that if you're under stress and you're exercising, that you don't come back. You don't feel that great the next day. You just are tired. The day after that, you are still sore. You just went over into the destructive category, and that is where you want to be careful. Now, this little rule that I just made does not count for when you're getting in shape and just starting up exercise. You might be sore for a week, okay? But that's different. I'm talking on when you've been exercising regularly. So, stress is an important one. And with that, go sleep. If you are sleep deprived, watch out. You're going to be so much more injury prone the next day, and that might be a really good day to go for a nice walk or do a few little sprints, right? I knew today was going to be a really long day. After a long weekend, I just loaded a lot longer than usual. So what did I do this morning? Instead of a jog, I did some sprint interval training, right? Went for a walk, run, went for a walk, run. Did that 5 times, not much stress, still got good exercise, didn't stress my adrenals. So, hydration. Hydration is an important one. And I'm not going to spend too much time on this, except to say it is the number one nutritional deficiency out there. And when you hydrate, people are always talking about how much hydration they need while exercising. It's front loading before exercise that really counts. So make sure a half hour before exercise, you have had your 8 to 12 ounces of water and you will recover much more effectively. Really, really important. Flexibility, another one. I just had a 14-year-old who came in today, tried to touch his knees and he came down to here. That was it. So I tried to sell him on the fact, because he loves soccer, he says, I can make you so much faster, right? I can make you so much more maneuverable just by getting more flexibility. And Blake, you will be seeing him, okay? So because flexibility is an absolutely critical part of being an athlete, and it gets underemphasized here in the United States. It's funny, when I went to school in the Netherlands, our gym class was almost all just flexibility stuff. I come over here and it's armor suited for football, and it's just such a different thing. So it's a bit cultural, but flexibility, make sure we spend the time on it. Do not stretch first thing in the morning, okay? Because that is when the joints are dry, things just need to warm up a bit. Stretching is best performed after exercise. That's when you're gonna get the best gains as far as flexibility. And then we can talk also about the types of exercise and all the benefits, right? And there's the walking fans, and there's the running fans, and the cycling, and the swimming. And first of all, get off the couch and move. yay, celebrate that. Let's not even discuss what's best, do something, okay? Once we're there, maybe a mix of things is really good, right? Because they all have their benefit. Walking gives you great emotional peace. It uses muscles that running or cycling doesn't use, and is really a good core basic exercise that I feel everybody should be doing. If you do a 10-minute walk to 15-minute walk after each meal, it's going to do tremendous things. I think you have a slide on that, so we'll be discussing that. But build it into your habit. You've already broken your day up with a meal. Walk afterwards, and that way, on even a crazy day that totally falls apart on you, even if you did 10 minutes after each meal, you still got a 30-minute walk in that day. Yeah, and the benefits of it are profound. Try to make sure that at least once or twice a week that your heart rate goes to close to its maximum, even if it's only for 15 or 20 seconds. What happens as we get out of shape, the low to high rate decreases and your heart becomes only capable of a smaller and smaller range, and that's aging. There's less reserve. If there is a problem with the heart, it doesn't have the oomph. You want that big elasticity, that means you gotta hit that low both sides. Really important. This is why interval training is so popular, because you get 5 15-second sprints in it, and that could be from the swimming or it could be bicycling, whatever way you do it. That then increases the benefit aerobically for that patient fourfold. So if you did, say, a 20-minute walk with four little sprints in there, that is the equivalent of at least an hour walk, if not more. So it's really scaling yourself. So we're gonna go into something very unique, and I was really excited that Dr. Greg was gonna do this. Dr. Greg is really into exercise, and he talked to me about the crucial movements, and that is just very, very central for all exercise. So take it away.
All right. I've got one, yeah. If I had to sum up all of my rehab classes into three basic concepts, it was core stability, proper diaphragmatic breathing, and glute activation. The three things we're terrible at. We're sitting all day, our glutes aren't getting any activation, our knees tend to dive in, we're chest breathing, which creates tightness through here. And when you have proper core stability, it does a bunch of different things. Core co-activation during any movement will increase your power by at least 10%. If you're recovering from an injury, whether it be in the ankle, the shoulder, the elbow, more than that. Core activation is crucial for every single joint in our body, mainly through something called fascia. So fascia is a really interesting concept. It started to get bigger the past 10 to 15 years. There's even a textbook written on it. Fascia is like the Saran wrap that covers all of our muscles. If I had to make an analogy for it, it would be the rope, the tug of war rope. The muscles are the people pulling. Fascia is the stuff coordinating that pull. And the core is a critical player in that. So proper diaphragmatic breathing, I'm gonna hit real quick. If you ever wonder how to move or breathe correctly, just look at a baby. Babies have something called primal movement patterns. It's pre-programmed, their body has to learn how to move properly. The neuromuscular coordination is there, and it's a pre-run program that they move through. So proper diaphragmatic breathing, you wanna think of your core as a brace. And you keep it kind of taut, and you want to breathe down into your stomach, into your pelvis. You don't want to be breathing up here like this. And so many of us do, and that's why we're tight through here, chronically tight through the back of our necks. Your shoulders should be sitting on your core and not hanging from your neck, if that makes any sense. And when we practice proper diaphragmatic breathing, we activate something called our transversus abdominis. And it comes all the way around and acts as a back brace. So if we're lifting stuff, we're doing a squat or a deadlift, it actually acts as a back brace and will protect us from injury. One of the biggest injuries people make when they're doing a deadlift is A, they don't hip hinge correctly, which I'm about to talk about, and they blow out a disc because they're not diaphragmatically breathing either. So I want to come up with movements that not only made us better athletes, but made us better at our activities of daily living. So the first thing we have to get, these two kind of go together, hip hinge and squat. whenever we're bending down, getting something off the floor, picking a heavy weight up, getting in, even getting into our car, we never want to do this. You should be completely stationary from here up and from here down. So you're hinging at the hip. See? And when you tie that into a squat, squat should look like this. So the basics of a good squat is, first off, proper glute activation. So we're making sure our knees aren't diving in. And a good way to start to activate the glutes is a band. You can tie a rubber, a TheraBand around your legs and push against it as you squat. Your knees should not come out past your toes, and you should be able to wiggle your toes in the squat. This is another big thing, especially when performing planks. You always want to keep the neck neutral. So when you're doing a squat, you don't want to look up. Keep it neutral, because even when you're doing a squat, you're activating something called the superficial back line. So you are putting pressure through the neck. And if you go like this, it can create so much pressure that you can blow a cervical disc. This has happened to a few people I've known. So whenever you're doing a complex lift, neutral neck, deadlift, neutral neck, you want to make sure that is all neutral. I don't recommend squats for everybody. It can be a tough lift to master. Split stance, this is a great modification of it. So this is your average lunge. Again, we're hip hinging. We're keeping our torso straight. And we're trying to do 90 degrees, 90 degrees, 90 degrees. You can do this weighted. You can do this uphills. And most of the stuff I'm going to be focusing on today is going to be body weight. And there's a good reason for that, and I'm going to hit that in a minute. Another activity that we use all the time is a push. Whether it's overhead lift, whether it's push this way. For this one, the main stuff, again, all these proper diaphragmatic breathing, every single one. So we're keeping a tight core. Bench press, tight core, push. You want to make sure your shoulder girdle, if you're doing weights, you want to make sure your shoulder girdle isn't coming too far forward. That opens up to injury. And you want, if you're doing a push-up, this is the perfect push exercise to do because it's a complex movement. We're activating our core. If you're doing a bench press, the bench is supporting your core. If you're doing a push-up, your core musculature has to keep everything firm and tight. Does that make sense? Okay, so I'm gonna perform a push-up. So the main thing with this is not sagging. Diaphragmatic breath. You want your hands to be internally rotated about 15 degrees. This protects the elbows and the shoulders. At the top, your scapula should come completely forward. We call it protracted. So this is a great scapular stabilization exercise. Good diaphragmatic breath. You come down till you touch, keeping that neutral neck, right? And all the way up. Planking. Same thing happens. Neutral neck, none of this. Don't let the hips sag. And just focus on breathing into it. It's going to be really difficult, but as you practice more and more, this is going to bring so much stability to your low back and glutes as well. It activates the entire back line. So we're really trying to hit complex exercises with all of these movements. Pull row. This is a really good one. We use this one a lot as well. Perfect pull row is going to be on a bench, dumbbell, we're pulling straight up. You could also do this with a TheraBand attached to the wall, we're pulling straight back. This one, you really want to make sure you're squeezing the scapula in and pulling like this. That's going to protect your rotator cuff. Okay? The muscles on this side of our scapula and our rotator cuff work in tandem, and if you're not using these pick up the slack. That make sense? Perfect. Another huge one for you golfers out there, you tennis players, anything with a club or a racket is rotation. again, ties into core, our power transfer between our upper extremities and our lower extremities. This is any movement we're bringing across. Tennis, golf. And Blake, actually, I think last year you posted a really great video on medicine ball lumberjacks. I would look that up. It's a really good, it's informational. This is, rotation is so important in so many sports, so it's something you really want to hit. And then again, the carry, farmer's carry, 5 gallon buckets, anything. This activates core, activates shoulder girdle, glutes, legs. It's a perfect full body workout. We did this a lot in school. My friends and I were big body weight freaks. So is body weight movement enough? Now, all those 7 exercises I showed you guys can be done with just body weight. And the reason I love body weight so much is because it requires creativity. It activates a lot more muscles than average weightlifting, as with the bench press push-up example I just gave. With a push-up, you're activating all your core musculature. You're using more of your shoulder girdle. You're activating your legs, your glutes, everything. Bench press, it's just a few. It's just your pec major, pec minor a little bit, and your triceps, and just a little bit of your shoulder girdle. People are afraid that they're going to lose their gains if you're big into weightlifting while you're doing bodyweight movements. And I'll tell you a little something about myself. Before I got into academia in this field, I was in the Marine Corps, and we didn't use weights. No weights. Everything we did was body weight or with packs, weighted vests. And they're arguably one of the fitter branches of the military out there. And we had some pretty ripped guys. And everything we did is body weight, because this is the main one. We have to maintain, we gotta be agile, we gotta have good endurance, and all that can be accomplished with body weight exercises. Increases proprioceptive awareness. What proprioception is it's, we have a lot of sensors in our muscles, our tendons, and they're constantly telling our brain where our body is in space. So the greater your proprioception, the less your chance of injury, which is really crucial. This is where wobble boards come in. That's a good way to increase proprioception. This is where Bosu balls, I know a favorite of Blake's, come in. So it's extremely important. People experience less rolled ankles, less sprains, less strains. And if you're doing body weight exercises, let's say you have a minor dysfunction, a movement issue, you're less likely to injure. We call that loading dysfunction. So if you're new to exercise, I highly recommend starting off with body weight, because you're less likely to injure yourself. Another huge thing, body weight exercises are functional. They can't be replicated by a lot of weights. There's a way you can replicate a push-up, you can do a bench press or dumbbells, or one of those two things. You can't replicate climbing a rope. You can't replicate swinging on monkey bars. You can't replicate crawling or a buddy drag, really. When I was still being sold on this in grad school, a friend of mine who really got me into functional movement made a bet with me. He's like, I'll bet that I can increase your squat by 15% if we follow this for 3 weeks. So that's what we did. Every single time we worked out, we did frog hops, we did all this crazy stuff, bear crawls, buddy drags, we did wheelbarrows, sprints, a whole slew of different exercises. And at the end of 3 weeks, I was blown away by my squat. It had increased by about 30 pounds. So this stuff works if you do it right. All right, cardio fitness. Seems counterintuitive that the best way to get better at cardio is not just getting out there and putting in 10, 15 miles and just pushing it further and further each time. But this is well studied, and again, going back to the Marine Corps for an anecdote here. When I first got in the Marine Corps, I'd been in the Marine Corps about a year. And during that year, we had something called the PFT. It's just our main fitness test. And during boot camp and school of infantry and stuff like that, we did a lot of really grueling, high intensity stuff. But the Marine Corps found that once we got out of that and into the fleet and more into like our day-to-day routine, unit readiness fell pretty drastically. And they couldn't figure out why, because they're like, we're running them, we're making them do push-ups, we're doing crunches. Crunches, another thing you didn't see on that list of necessary movements, right? Pretty useless for core stability. All you're working is this muscle right here, and it does nothing for core stability. Either way, they couldn't figure out why until they switched it up. They switched up our fitness test and our fitness routine to include high intensity interval stuff. Then we're running with friends on our backs, firemen carry runs. We're dragging them like this with their feet dragging. We're crawling on the ground. We're throwing weights. We're doing, you know, complex thrusters, stuff like that. We're doing sprints in our boots. And all of a sudden, unit readiness skyrocketed because this stuff works. In fact, just 5 4-minute rounds of exercise at 87 to 97% maximum heart rate. They did a study with semi-pro soccer players, and they were able to maintain their VO2 max by doing just this every week or every other week, just once. So it's 20 minutes every other week, and they're able to maintain their VO2 max. So VO2 max is your body's ability to burn oxygen and turn it into energy. So their muscles were just as efficient by just doing this. I'd say this is a great way to maintain. If you're working your way up, if you want to increase your VO2 max, Tabata is the way to go. I hate Tabata workouts because they're miserable, but you get good results. So Tabata is kind of a CrossFit thing. Kind of started with that. You do 20 seconds maximum intensity. So you're on a treadmill, you're on a bike. You'd be doing this with burpees, thrusters with weights. 20 seconds as hard as you can go, 10 second rest. 20 seconds again, and you repeat that until you've done it for 4 minutes. Do this 4 times a week. So for 16 minutes a week, you can get an 8% improvement in your VO2 max. That's pretty huge. And the average improvement they noted in this study in muscular endurance went up by 80%. It's unbelievable. So you don't need a lot of time to work out. This is something you can work into your daily routine. Who doesn't have 4 minutes after work or 4 minutes in the morning 4 days a week? To improve overall fitness, you want a good sampling of different movements for overall fitness. 7 to 10 minutes rotation, one of each of the crucial movement categories that we showed earlier until the time is up. So that could be doing for a good twist or rotational motion. That could be a push up and at the top, turn. I'll demonstrate. So you kind of widen your feet a little bit. You come up, rotate. So you do like 30 to 45 seconds of that. And you move on to the next one, maybe do air squats. And then you can move on, you can carry some heavy weights. So you just want to rotate and get a good sampling of each of the movements. That way you're working every single part of the body at the same time you're working on breath and core stability. This is one of my favorite ones, just if Tabata seems kind of daunting that day, I'll go for the 10 minute instead of the 4. All right, this one's awesome. Since I'm giving a little talk on keto next, this ties into it really well because of the mitochondrial biogenesis. So, I'm sure you've heard Dr. denBoer give this spiel many times about mitochondria being the power packs of the cell. All right, these are the ones in which we combine the stuff we eat with oxygen to make fuel. And the more of them we have, the more energy our cells have to complete their activities, their making of neurotransmitters, hormones, maintain cellular integrity, and fueling our muscle cells. More mitochondria equals more metabolism, more calories burned, okay? So for this one is 4 30-second sprints. If that seems like too much, you can drop it down to 3 sets of 5 4 second sprints. So you sprint for 4 seconds, 20 second rest. Sprint for four, you do that 5 times, that's one set. Do it 3 more times. And this will also greatly improve insulin sensitivity. And that's not something that's unique just to this one. You move it all, you're improving insulin sensitivity. But all these are about the minimum dose, right? So if you want to get fit, this is a minimum dose of what you can do. Ideally, the best workout plan, mix and match any one of these, okay? Boom. For us that, for those of us who aren't trying to reinvent the exercise wheel and just want to get outside, just a 15-minute walk at a moderate pace after a meal, I was talking 2-3 miles an hour, there's a blunting of the post-meal glucose and insulin spike. So this is going to lower your chances for type 2 diabetes, for insulin sensitivity and insulin insensitivity and resistance. Type 3 diabetes, which is Alzheimer's, they've termed it type 3 diabetes. All those different dysglycemic conditions can be attenuated and moderated just by moving after a meal. It's pretty powerful stuff. Okay. This is something I'm pretty passionate about. I remember the first time I heard about keto, I was sitting in my grad school clinical biochem class, and I had this crazy professor, really bright guy, pretty spastic, and I knew a little tidbit was coming because he just had this maniacal look in his eye, and he was getting himself worked up into a frenzy. And he was talking about athletes. He's like, when you're ketogenic, he's like, you're burning fat for fuel. We put these guys on a treadmill, we can inject them with insulin, and nothing will happen to them. He's like, if I did that to one of you guys, you'd be off that treadmill in a second. So it's a pretty powerful switch. We have two forms of fuel that we can burn. One is glucose, which is the breakdown product of carbohydrates. It's a good fuel, as long as you're eating the right kind of carbs. Ones that don't spike your blood sugar and spike your insulin. Low glycemic carbs, carbs with a lot of fiber, carbs and vegetables. But we can also burn ketone bodies. And ketone bodies are the breakdown product of fat. So how do we hit this metabolic switch? This is something that's hormone dependent. If we have insulin in our bloodstream, we're using carbs. Insulin activates all the pathways that burn carbs. Insulin activates fat storage. Insulin activates glycogen storage. Insulin activates a lot of cholesterol synthesis from our dietary carbohydrates. Ketogenic diet, the hormone kind of guiding and activating that is glucagon. I'm not getting all the crazy biochemistry behind it, but in order to get into a state of ketosis, we need to have very little carbs in our diet so we don't activate the insulin pathway. The perfect ketogenic diet is about 70-75% fat, healthy fats, plant-based fats. About 20% or less of protein, and definitely less than 10% of carbs. So if you're eating an average 2,000 a day calorie diet, this is less than 50 grams of carbs. Okay, and you're gonna get most of that in your vegetables. What ketogenic diet does is ketone bodies, they bind to something called the promoter region in our DNA. And promoter regions activate not just one gene or two, entire networks of genes. We're tapping into an ancient metabolic setting when we do this, and we go into fat burning mode. So our HDL cholesterol goes up. Our triglycerides go down. Triglycerides are made from carbohydrates. So when we get a huge insulin spike, triglycerides are made. So this is going to even out your blood lipid profiles. It's anti-inflammatory. The ketogenic diet's been used since the early 1900s to treat intractable seizure disorders, untouched by medication. There's been a lot of theories on how this works, and I think they all have a little bit of truth to them. The main thing is that the ketogenic diet is a clean energy source. And when I first heard this is actually, I was listening to one of Dr. denBoer's seminars on the fast mimicking diet, ketogenic diet, and he mentioned that it was a clean energy source, and I was like, what? So I told him, it threw me into this spiral of research where I spent, I think, 15 hours trying to get to the bottom of that. And at the end of the day, it's a really elegant way, biochemical magic, really, in which we create less free radicals when we burn ketone bodies. So that clean energy source makes our mitochondria more efficient, less prone to oxidative stress. In a healthy mitochondria is one that maintains a healthy cellular membrane. And in neurons, that's extremely important, since neurons are really sensitive to disturbances in the membrane. It makes them closer and closer to threshold. And with seizures, it's a sporadic depolarization, a sporadic electrical signal spread between neurons. So that's part of the theory, is that poor mitochondrial function equals poor membrane integrity equals uncontrolled signaling. So that's a really cool part of the ketogenic diet. And lastly, it can improve athletic performance. So how does it do that? Do we all know what bonking is? I had a professor say, if you want a good time, take a chair, bring it to mile 19 of a marathon, and watch people crash. That tends to be when people run out of their glycogen stores. This is a storage form of carbohydrates, of our glucose. We can store up to 2,000 calories between our liver and our muscles. It runs out. And if we're not using fat as fuel, we bonk. And there's a few miles it takes for our bodies to actually start burning that fat. But if you're burning fat from the beginning, you don't bonk. Instead of 2,000, for example, I'm about 13% body fat. Doesn't seem like a lot, but that's still 190,000 calories of fuel that I have stored in my body compared to 2,000 in glycogen. Now, a big critique of the ketogenic diet that seems to be pretty popular is that it'll hurt your performance in explosive lifting, in any weightlifting competition, but it's actually not true. Although when you're going into ketosis, you have to burn through your glycogen to force your body into burning fat as fuel. But when you get into ketosis, when it becomes something called keto-adapted, your body starts making a little, it won't be as much glycogen, it won't be 2,000 calories, but it starts making more and stores it in the muscle instead of the liver. And that you can use locally if you need that extra burst of speed. And you're not gonna be using as much glycogen because, again, if you're not going crazy intense, you're using ketone bodies. Even ketone bodies themselves exert anti-inflammatory qualities without even the metabolic aspect of it. Honestly, as much as we know about it, we're still uncovering new stuff every day. It changes the microbiome. That's another theory on how it affects seizures. A study that just came out a couple months ago, I think. Okay. Any questions on ketogenic diet? Anything that I covered at all? No? All right, Dr. denBoer is going to hit a few supplements.
Excellent. So, one more word on the ketogenic diet is Dr. Greg, Don, and I have spent many, many hours putting together the DBC version of the ketogenic diet because we're very unhappy with what's out there. People are eating lots of bacon and cream and all kinds of dairy products that are inflammatory. And yes, they achieve a state of ketosis, but at what cost, right? Health. And we like to use it as a reset diet. So it's a temporary program if an athlete's going into competition or we need to lose weight or we need to get a bipolar mood disorder under control, right? If we just need to change a patient, then what we have done is we have designed this program that's super healthy, and Don can throw that into action with you in just one session if it needs to be, where we teach you how to do keto right, because there's a lot of weird ways to do keto. And I was not happy with what I saw out there. Now that it's almost become a fad, you know how the USA is, that people are doing it wrong multiple times. Keto's origins was actually as procedure disorders, as you mentioned. It was first done in 1927 in the Netherlands, where this very brilliant biochemist was able to figure out some of the pathways that you were talking. And back in 1927, he says, I think I can really hit good things in the neurological system. And so its first use was actually for the brain. So it's very popular to this day. I find very good results with my autistic patients, by the way. It has an incredible calming effect on them. So I'm very much a fan at finding shortcuts. If I could do something easier and get more done, I want to do it as long as it's healthy, as long as it's good for the patient, right? That's why we like the interval training. That's why I love doing those key movements where in 10 minutes you can get an awesome workout in. And who wouldn't want that 80% faster or better performance by muscles by doing some Tabata? In a way, that's called biohacking. And biohacking is a new science that's out there, somewhat controversial because some people take it to an extreme. I'm giving you things that have been science proven, clinically validated, and I'd like to cover a few of them. This is how I biohack my patients to get a lot better, a lot faster results. One of them is the keto diet, right? The other way, one is making sure that we do exercises very efficiently. Number three is to use specific nutraceuticals. One of them is MitoBoost. MitoBoost is a product designed to upregulate mitochondrial function. Again, mitochondria is the energy cell pack that fuels a cell. So if you have lots of mitochondria here, you're gonna have lots of explosive power. If you have a lot of mitochondria here, your IQ will go up. We have proven that you can change IQ very dramatically for the better or for worse by changing mitochondrial function. We've done this in studies of patients over 80 years old that can reduce their cognitive decline and increase their IQ to better than they had ever had in their life at age 80 or up. So it is amazing what the mitochondria can do. And MitoBoost is based on a formula that comes from Berkeley about 15 years ago. University of Berkeley was granted a very large sum of money by a pharmaceutical firm to try to figure out how can we upregulate mitochondrial function in AIDS patients, because it really helps outcome in AIDS. So one little thing they forgot in the contract, they forgot to write in there it must be a pharmaceutical. So these researchers happily started researching, and they came up with all kinds of things, and finally came up with a formula that outperformed anything. Nothing even came close, and it just happened to be nutraceuticals, natural agents. So they were able to run the clinical trials. They were able to upregulate the mitochondrial function so significantly in AIDS patients that a lot of their symptoms just went away. Now we use this with patients with chronic fatigue, your fibromyalgias, our professional athletes to increase performance times, reactivity times to prevent injuries, and that's called MitoBoost. And so I think it's kind of humorous because this is one of the few studies out there that unintentionally did not promote a pharmaceutical but a nutraceutical. I would have liked to have seen that meeting when that research was released. So inflavonoid is another one. This is a very new formula using turmeric, or turmeric as some people call it. Turmeric has thousands of year history as being a very powerful but natural anti-inflammatory. It reduces that soreness time. If the patient's injured, it can reduce swelling and downtime very significantly. It's based on European research that takes turmeric and puts just a little bit of hops with it and a little bit of fenugreek, about 7% fenugreek, that enhances absorbability more than 45-fold. So we're talking close to the action of prednisone here, folks, and it's natural and it's good for you. Normal turmeric will actually be absorbed by only 6 or 7%. So inflavonoid is a cool one. Whenever I do some of my crazy exercise, I always take inflavonoid so I'm not sore the next day. So fish oil is a must-do for joint health, and fish oil often has quality control problems. We run ours through three different checkpoints at time of collection, at time of manufacture, and a third party independent that also checks quality to make sure everything is right about it. The fat soluble vitamin C, the only one on the market that's actually fat soluble, it goes into the white blood cells and red blood cells. If you are a Tour de France fan, it just started this week, and Tour de France, when they hit the Alps and the Pyrenees, it gets unbelievably intense, and the oxidative stress on these people is so unbelievable that they start taking vitamin C to combat that. They use ultra potent C almost exclusively because it sticks to their bodies, and they will take up to 20 a day. That's how much they burn through to do the damage control. It's amazing to me because I think if I took 10, I'd have diarrhea, right? That it goes beyond what the bowels can manage. But at that point, the body's just soaking it up as fuel to do the repair. So ultra potent C is really good for athletes. Ultra potent C also increases elasticity of the ligaments and tendons, and yes, has been proven to reduce wrinkling because of that. So I think, personally, so this is an opinion now, and not science, I think it's one of the better antioxidant, anti-aging type of vitamins out there. Linus Pauling got a Nobel Prize back in the 1950s for his research in vitamin C that proved that every decade beyond age 50, we have to increase our vitamin C by 1,000 in order to keep up with the oxidative stress of aging. Did that make sense? Sort of. So magnesium, we go through magnesium. It's an important fuel for the muscle. We prefer magnesium glycinate because one, it does not upset the bowels, and it's 6 times more bioavailable than regular magnesium. And this is a new product called Collagen. It just came off of prescription. It's got a ton of research. It's 3 different prescription modes are in one product. It's basically taking type 1 collagen, type 2 collagen, and something called hyaluronic acid, and combines these 3 products so it supports your synovial fluid, your lubricating fluid, your cartilage, ligaments, and tendons. So when we rehabilitate a joint, we always put a patient on collagen. I was just privileged to have a patient because I haven't had it that long. So this patient was now 1 month 2. She has bone on bone in both knees. She's in her early 70s, and she says, "Doc, I think I'm way too old for a knee replacement. Can you do something?" So what I did is I put her on this, and now, for the first time in a long time, she's back to playing tennis. And I'm going, "Oh, that's maybe a little extreme." She's playing twice a week. She says the only time she has pain now is when she sits too long, like in a restaurant, and she has to get up. She's kind of stiff. In just 2 months, she was barely walking 2 months ago. I was so shocked to see her today. So pretty cool stuff. Silica Renew has been marketed in Europe. Its research is from Belgium, published in the medical journals there for hair regrowth. And it increases density of hair as well as thickness of hair by an average of 15% within 10 months. It also decreases wrinkling in the skin by an average of 50% in 1 year. Silica Renew has a really solid track record because it again supports ligaments, tendons, and elastic kind of tissue. I like a combination of glucosamine, chondroitin sulfate, and bromelain. This will restore cartilage loss. And in knee and hip studies coming out of Italy, and at last count, when I did a research on how many good clinical trials have been done on it, 73 clinical trials on this product, shown that on x-ray, you can actually restore, regrow lost cartilage. The bromelain is a proteolytic enzyme, which means it's an enzyme that gets rid of debris, and it's derived from pineapple and helps the absorption of those other two. When you use glucosamine, by the way, it's got to be glucosamine sulfate, okay? Not hydrochloride, which is not bioavailable and could actually cause toxicity because most of those products are from China. So we are really tight on the quality control here. So for protein, we do not like whey. Whey tends to be very inflammatory. Even though it's supposedly the perfect protein, it's not very bioavailable in a lot of people because they have an inflamed gut. Inflammation of the gut is a problem that exists with over 80% of us. So whey protein worsens that problem, causes sugar dysregulation, and increases inflammation. Tends to be a very dirty protein also. It's popular because it's cheap. We like plant-based, okay? plant-based is not as bioavailable, but it's so much richer in nutrients. It really re-nourishes. And we have found a way to combine a bunch of different kind of plant proteins so it matches way as far as perfectness of the protein without the inflammation, and it's actually healthy. So one serving equals 20 grams. It's a lot. Endura is just being reformulated to become a recovery drink. So if you're doing Tour de France afterwards, guess what you're drinking? It's Endura. It's an electrolyte restoration drink also. And the original formula reduces the soreness by about 40% after exercise. I haven't seen the data on the new Endura yet. It's coming out soon, and I'm excited to see it. So there's kind of a quick overview of some of the ways that we biohack our patients to improve performance and get better results, and at the same time, help overall health. That's the magic word. We don't do anything here that artificially stimulates performance. It's gotta be real, and this can be all done at any age, right? Some of the things that Dr. Greg was demonstrating, I was thinking, okay, how do we do this with a 75-year-old who's never exercised? There's ways to modify it and do baby steps into it, right? The push-ups can be done on knees. You can do partial push-ups. You can even do the push-ups on a chair like this, where it's just a little bit easier, right? The same thing with a plank. You don't have to go all the way down. You can modify it by even doing something like this and holding while pushing your stomach in. Any movement is beneficial. I've seen in the very, very elderly that are almost immobile, if they do 10 little squats holding on to something twice a day, that their leg strength improved by over 30% in just 1 month. It is unreal what you can do with exercise and what an impact it has emotionally also. Whenever we get a case of ADHD in our office, I preach to them, get rid of the chemicals, get rid of the food colors, right? Let's increase the fats, let's feed the brain good things, and you have an incredible tool for this kid at home. It's one of the best tools I know. It's called the backyard. Get them out there. Exercise, yeah? It's one thing that I've noticed a huge difference between the US and the Netherlands, where I grew up, is the streets are kind of quiet. And what I'm used to is everybody's outside all the time. And I think it's one of the main differences in health of the US versus Europe. I love the US, but I do not love how we administer healthcare, and I don't love the health of the nation. And I'm on a mission to change that. So this is where it starts, with exercise. Thanks for being here. Thanks. Thank you. Any questions?